Okay, so this is just a short presentation about the process we use to make elephants dream. As we know, elephants don't normally dream, but we can make them do that. And the project started as an overview of all the scenes in the movie, one by one. So when we started the project, we had a bunch of goals. The first one was to actually make the movie. That was the one we were the least sure that we would actually do. I think it was only until the last month of the project that we... So that was our toughest goal, actually. But we wanted to do some other things. We wanted to prove to people that, yes, you could do a full-scale movie production using just open source tools. There is a little bit of a caveat to that, is that we only focus on the visual part. The audio, we didn't actually do in the studio. We had a sponsoring sound studio that did the work for us. I think I was a big open source enthusiast, but he does not use open source software to do any of the audio work. So all of the sound stuff was done with the closed source programs. The secondary corollary to that goal was that we had to, in some cases, enhance the software to make it possible, specifically with Blender, because that was the Blender Foundation is what started this project, and it's a main production tool, and that really needed a lot of enhancements to actually make our goal possible. And that was one of the benefits of the project. And of course, to promote that so that people know that we can do such things, and sort of extend the idea of open content, open source, to some area where people don't normally think in those terms. And have a movie that in itself is sort of open source in the sense that you have access to the production files and you can make your own versions of it at a very low level if you want, and to share our knowledge so that other people can start doing similar things. Okay, this is... Hello? Can you even hear me now? Good. Okay. So, speaking about that, some of those improvements that we did, about a month before the project, Tom Rosendahl recoded the entire animation system in Blender. And there were a lot of things that were done to make the project possible. The old system was very, very slow because it did not have any calculation of dependencies. So you have one object depending on another object for the animation to work. You would have to have that information internally, and Blender didn't have that. What it would do, it would calculate the whole scene multiple times in an effort to satisfy all the dependencies, which has two effects. One thing is that things are really slow when you do that on a complex scene. The other effect is that if two or three or four times are not enough, then something isn't going to behave quite the way you set it up at the end. So it's a very brute force. So the big thing was having that dependency graph in there that really had a massive, I mean, the speed is the single most important thing that we have. The armature, the Blender uses basically looks like this. It's I'm sorry, the resolution is very different from what I know, but it didn't display, so I'm having a hard time finding So this is a control armature for a character, and it's basically a number of objects, like a number of bones that you can sort of transform, and by transforming them they deform a mesh, such as this one. That's using the armature. So the armature objects are bones that you deform the skin with, and you can get some animation out of that. And the armatures went through a bunch of enhancements for the project, some of which are immediately visible. There is the armature. So for instance, you can see that it has multiple layers. So you can actually organize your controls onto different layers, which is pretty important, because if you add up all the controls that are available to an animator in this rig, you get a lot of things to select and click on at the same time. And so just being able to organize it on layers is a huge enhancement. You can give the bones custom shapes that the rigger can decide on, which makes things easier to select. And there are other important improvements to the animation system that we did for Orange. Like you can do a repeating action, and use a bone that moves in that action to measure a stride length. So then you can put that action on the path and have the cycle repeat itself moving forward. So that, for instance, the character can walk on a path without having sliding feet, because it's matching the speed of the cycle to the length of the stride on the path. Another nice feature is drivers, where you can link the animation curve of one object instead of to time to a transformation of another object. So you can use one thing to control another very flexibly in the UI. So that was another big improvement. Improvements to the particle system that we saw in the movie, that you can make hair for characters using particles. Material nodes. Halfway through the project, we had a nodal editor added into Blender, which works on a graph system similar to Gagle. And it can be used two areas. Currently, it can be used in two areas of Blender. One is in the material system. The old material system has a very kind of fixed structure, where you have a material with 8 texture slots, and you can do only so much with it. And using a graph system allows you to mix multiple materials in different ways. So you can do kind of unique things that you can't really do with one material. Like you can have two specular highlights instead of one, and fake like a multi-layered material, where you can have something disappear when it gets brighter. And that can be a layer of the material. So if you have something that has a radically different appearance in the bright light than dark, you can deal with that. The other area where the material, where the node system is used, is in the compositor, which is really pretty close to what Gagle is. OpenEXR was used as sort of a nice library that Blender can use internally, and also as the format, because it supports multiple layers per file, and you can have different passes in those layers that are custom passes that the software knows about. It's a nice architecture, so we use that heavily. And the nodal compositor is in a large part responsible for the final look of the movie. Every single frame is heavily composited in the end. Something that we didn't have, wasn't coded specifically for the project, but was very useful for it, was the video sequence editor, which is a small rendering program inside of Blender. Independently had some major enhancements to it. There's a memory cache limiter in it, so instead of trying to cache your whole sequence into memory as you scrub through it the first time, it only caches what you need as you're running along. It's very fast, and it doesn't blow up the amount of RAM you use in a long sequence. That makes it actually usable. Also, the integration of FFmpeg library into the sequence editor so that they could deal with more file formats than they could previously, and some speedups and enhancements. And the library enhancement, Blender has a system for the project files in which they are linked. You can link data from one file into another. That's what I mean about the library. There were a lot of bug fixes that happened for the project. And also, a new concept is that you can have multiple objects in a scene, and you can declare them as a group. For instance, in this case, that's actually being used. If you look at the character here, it's this grayed out wireframe is actually part of a group that's composed of actually about maybe 50 or 60 objects that is being linked from another file and then used in this file with a proxy armature to move it around. The proxy feature, the armature proxy feature, we didn't have to in the project, but we did have the link group. And so the benefit of that is that we could have a library of sets and characters, and that we could then link those into each shot. And then you can make changes to the set, you can make changes to the characters, and you wouldn't have to go into each shot and sort of recopy those changes. And the kind of downside we had during the project is that we didn't have a good way of animating these linked things. So our two main characters in the movie, Groove and Eno, are appended rather than linked in, so that actually made it a copy of a big shot file, which meant that our technical director had to constantly swap out the old characters with new versions, which was a time-consuming and error-prone operation, even with scripting. He wouldn't have had to do that, so that's kind of the nice thing that happened after the project. I'll go on. Oh, the NLA integration is just that if you're not actually posing the character in your scene, if you're just using canned animations on it, during the project, we were able to use different canned animation on the same thing. And so we could have those secondary characters that you don't really animate too carefully in the background, all linked, and using canned animations that were mixed together on NLA, which is kind of like a video editor for animation, because you stick animation clips next to each other and blend them and make new versions of them. So this picture here was our idea for how the production pipeline would look, that we would have a relatively clean divide between pre-production and production. And so the pre-production pipeline is going more or less horizontally in this picture. So we start out from our idea or concept, which was two guys and a machine in this case. And that we go on, we had actually hired a scriptwriter to do the script. And that when we arrived, a few months later, the script would be complete. And so here, the concepts line is when all the artists are in the studio, and we would start going with the idea and the script, and make character concepts, do the storyboard, make an animatic, which is a rough pre-visualization movie, and once the concepts were done and the storyboard was finalized, we could start modeling, rigging, do the voice recording, and then start our animation process, which is the most time-consuming thing to do, is to animate all those shots, and add textures and materials like render and composite and edit. And you can think in this second phase of production that it's like a pipeline. And so each shot has to go through that pipeline. They don't all have to happen at the same time, but that's generally a shot has to get animated, lit, rendered, composited, and edited. That's not exactly how it happens in the actual production. So So this is more what it looks like, and there wasn't really that big a difference between pre-production and production. First of all, we had some usual, I think every production has catastrophes and disasters, and we had our share of those. So our scriptwriter quit and didn't tell us, so when we arrived to do our concepts, we found out that we didn't have a script, and that we had to find a new scriptwriter. And so pre-production time, we constantly didn't have a script, and we were working with a new writer iteratively to get to a script that we could actually use while we were doing other things. We dropped doing a 2D storyboard, mainly because our producer, Tom Rosendahl, who was the writer of the lead developer of Blender, wanted us to do everything in 3D. And so he said, don't do a storyboard, do an animatic straight out. So we did three of them. And I can show you what the animatics look like to just get an idea. So the first animatic we dubbed the Fracumatic. And it was done before we had really any script. And so we kind of invented it as we went along. We had a little bit of a script, but not much, and not all the scenes. We didn't have an ending, and we didn't have some parts in the middle. And basically, each artist, we brainstormed, we came up with some scenes, and each artist was given a scene and some very kind of rough idea of it. And each person kind of did their own animatic for that scene, however they felt they should do it. And so they all the scenes look very different in the Fracumatic. So when you put it next to each other, it doesn't look consistent at all. And we did it in different ways. For instance, I did this particular one. And you can see that there are lots of scenes within the blend file. And it's always fun. So here's a shot in 3D. Let's kill some of these things. So let's go to camera view. And so here's a shot that I was doing in 3D with some animation. And then the next shot I would do in a different scene, and I would render all those out into little OpenGL strips. And so we can see some of the other shots. For instance, shot two. And what I used was something that we had from that phase of our modeling, that we had the characters' heads, well, Prue's face and Emo's head more or less done. And so I basically just stuck those on some simple things that I made just for the scene and rigged them just for the scene. And then I did this really crappy animation. And so then you got this sequence, which just go to the beginning of it, so, which looks something like this. It's very, very crude. Actually, I don't think I rigged in this phase. I just moved their bodies around, you know, because it was. And this scene isn't in the final movie at all. So this work is down the tubes. So I can show some more from also from this Fracumatic phase, you can see this other, there's a dead character and this is supposed to be some kind of healing animation. That's it. So there's all sorts of these. I'll show you one that's a scene that's a little bit unique, is the typewriter scene, because we kind of knew what it was going to be all along. And Andy did this animatic, and you can see for his characters, he used actual Blender armature objects, which he then animated. So he didn't rig anything, he just used the actual armature as like a stand-in for the character. And so when we edited these together, we had this kind of difference, you know, so you just have to know that the characters are changing all the time. And that was the cracking at it phase. And we also did, so I can just show you when you go into the production. So actually this is a little bit interesting to look at. Here's, this stuff is actually on the DVD for the project, and it's a snapshot of our production SVN checkout, the last one. And so you can see that in production, there's a bunch of folders that each represent a scene. So 01, prologue, 02, scissor attack. And then there's a library folder. And the library folder contains all the data that's linked and in some unfortunate cases appended into the shop files. So it's everything that you need. It's also divided into directories. So there's Prune and Emo, who are, you know, the characters, and basically the important part is Prune.blend in here. There's working directories that we could sort of trash around and do experiments in as well. There's a headless giant character with huge hands at the end of the movie. I don't know if you have seen it, but we call that the headless giant. The machine has all the different sets that we link in, and so on and so forth. There's a directory with different Python scripts that we use. As you can see, most of them have the name Doctor, the Doctor or something or another. My favorite one is Doctor Epilepsy. You can ask me about it. And so if you look into a directory for a scene, you'll see a bunch of blend files. Each one is numbered with the shot from that scene. And you'll also see an AN2 directory, which is the second animatic. I think one of the animatics got lost from the SVN just because of the way we worked on things. We overloaded the files. So you can see, so this is the second scene, which actually survives pretty much in the movie. And by the second animatic, I had both these proxy characters that are sort of wearing pajamas and rigged, and the second animatic on, start using consistent character models throughout the whole thing, and more or less consistent guidelines. We had a version of the script to work with at the time, so everything is more or less it's more or less the same. So I'm going to go to the typewriter scene because that stays the same. And we can see some of them. I'll go into to solid now. It's faster. So you can see some. We also had huge resolution screens. So so here's a shot of the typewriter scene. Now, what we did for the second animatic, which I can't show here how it worked, unfortunately, is you can see that on the timeline below, there's these markers which have either cam or sub written on them. And we had a Python script running on frame change that would switch the cameras and would put subtitles of the dialogue at the bottom of the screen for the animatic. Unfortunately, the Python API for the markers changed both during and after the project. And so that script no longer functions modified. It would need to be adapted to the new API, which is why I can't actually show you the shot as intended, unless I can, if I open. I may have an old enough blender in here. This has the orange splash screen, which is the typewriter from the native one. So, let's
trying to enable us to get these gifts that we're receiving in. I think the version I have here is still too new for the API to function. So, in any case, so that was the animatics that we were making, and there were actually quite a bit of work to do. So, while we were making the animatics, we would email the writer and come into the office and talk, and we would have a new version of the script. And we had something that was maybe 10 or 12 scenes, and that was a lot of pages with a lot of dialogue, and we were just trying to cram that into the animatic. The shot with the bottle was, a scene with the bottle was like 35 shots by itself, and had a lot of talk in it. And around this time of animatic 2, we were very desperate feeling because we hadn't actually started production, and we were about 3 months into the 6 month time that we had allotted for it. And we made some massive cuts on the script. So we got it down from like a few pages of dialogue to one page that was condensed into 8 scenes instead of the original 12, and we cut a lot of the work that we did. And we were doing things during this animatic phase. We were modeling the characters because we couldn't wait to do things like that until, you know, afterwards. So we were modeling the characters in the set, and we started the rigging process. Now, what I naively thought at the beginning of the project was that you could rig the characters and then start your animation. What really happened was that the rigging process took about as long as the animation process did, and they had to happen side by side. And so the first character models we had didn't have facial controls. They didn't have textures either, which is a different thing. And but we had to start the animation anyway. And this is where linking groups with proxies would have really come in handy, but we didn't have that. So what we had to do was start animation and with the kind of what we had at the time, and then every now and then through the project, we had to go back to our old scenes, and let's say the facial controls were now ready, and swap the characters, which is time-consuming because sometimes animators do custom things in the shop. Like they add a special constraint onto a rig. And so now you have to not only drop in the new version, but you have to do some detective work to figure out what that person did. They don't necessarily remember what they did, and kind of make it so it works again. And we had to do that multiple times throughout the project. At first, I was doing it because I was doing the character rigging, and then I gave that task to the TD towards the end, once it got more kind of predictable as to what had to be done in the shot. So, and the rigging actually, even you could say, went on a little bit after the animation, because after you had animated everything and checked it for bad deformations and things like that, you might have to go into each shot and kind of tweak right in that shot to kind of get that wrist not to look ugly or something like that. It was a good experience. It's not that weird for movie productions to be like that. It's not just like, oh, we used open source software, so we had just a bunch of junk, and of course we had to do things like that. Obviously, these things change, but I remember very early, like, seeing an ILM presentation about one of the new Star Wars movies, and they had to do a lot of shot-per-shot tweaks. And of course, they had a lot more people working on it to throw on those shot-per-shot tweaks, and they didn't just think exactly that. Another thing that was kind of cool was that the editing didn't happen at the end. It was very, very useful to start editing the movie before we had rendered it. And using those OpenGL
snapshots. We could just render out OpenGL sequences and do what we call the live edit. I can show the file. Screenshot of it yesterday when Martin was doing his presentation, actually. So, projects. And if you don't, no, I don't think I copied it to this computer, so I can't even show it. But we had a live edit which has basically as animators were working. They would render out a little OpenGL preview of their animation, and I would drop it into the sequence editor in Blender, which is the same as you saw for the first animatic shot, and edit. And it was very useful to do that, because instead of animating single actions as one long action that you then cut, we would just animate shots. And oftentimes, it would be two different people animating two different shots, but they're right next to each other. And they could cut in the middle of the dialogue. And because we had this live edit, and I was animation director, I could see that transition and make them adjust the motions and poses of their individual shots so that when we edited it, it matched up and it didn't look too jarring or different. And it worked better on some scenes than others, mainly because we started working together better. But it was really valuable because animating long sequences like that really burns animators out. It's really hard to do. If you have a lot of camera changes, it becomes more tricky because usually you're trying to animate from the perspective of the camera to look good from the camera's point of view. So if the camera's changing with animation and you're jumping to different locations, then it becomes a little bit trickier to kind of mentally manage the whole thing. So it's really a lot easier for us for that reason. So that was the live edit. And the nice thing about the live edit was it actually contained all the editing decisions that we were going to do in the movie. And so when we rendered all the shots, we already had our edit done. And so we just had to drop in the rendered frames instead of the OpenGL frames, and it was done. I wasn't actually even though I edited the movie, I actually wasn't even in the studio when the final rendered version was produced. I was actually, at that time, at home, but I was checking in and out of SVN when I did that. Of course, after animation, or during animation in some cases, textures and materials had to be added, the lighting had to be done. This lighting, compositing, rendering, and a big chunk of the materials and texturing actually happened in this insane pace in the last month or so of the movie, where our two main lighting and rendering guys were working really crazy hours and going nuts trying to get it rendered. And it wasn't just a simple case of doing that, they were often going back to the animators for tweaks, because a lot of problems don't show up until you actually render it, and then you go, whoops, you know. And so that was going on then. And then in the last day or two before the premiere, we actually rendered the last shot and put it in. And we had to rush the morning of the premiere to the place where they did the digital transfer. There were problems, so we were delayed. And so we're really working on the project until the moment that, you know, we sat down in the audience and we played the movie on the big screen. So really nice. And we really depended on Blender heavily for all of this. Even things like file format conversions, we ended up doing a lot in Blender because you could do things in the sequence editor where you just drop in a sequence and open the XR and you get and you render it out to PNG frames or to I think we used like some Cineon or some other format like that for the transfer to the beta tape that we projected. So that's kind of an overview of the production. The really good thing to do was to take some lessons learned by software development projects and just use them in an animation project and hope that they worked. Like using an SVN for all our artwork was something that hadn't actually occurred to us before. But it worked really well. It really didn't give us many problems at all. We had fears that with so much binary data that the SVN repository would get huge, but because it's doing binary diffing and compressing, I think at all stages of the project, even at the end of the huge textures, the SVN repository was always smaller than a single checkout in size. So that's really, really manageable. And it was even possible for me to go to the US during the last month and do a full SVN checkout onto my desktop computer at home over the web. And it just ran, I think it ran overnight, and I had the entire project, like 8 gigs or something like that. So it's quite cool. This was the software that we used to accomplish this pipeline. Like I said, our workhorse was Blender, and we used it for a lot of things that you traditionally don't use a 3D package for. So we used it for modeling and animation and rendering, but we also used it for compositing, because at the time, we didn't find a good open source compositor that we could use. So the result was we coded one into Blender. The good thing of that was the tight integration between composite and render is really, really cool. And it's really beneficial, and to the point where I probably wouldn't use an external compositor on Blender data like 90% of the time, even if one was available, because you actually kind of composite before you render. If you're doing animations, you can tweak the composite on one shot. You see, render up one frame of a shot, and you see how it looks. And for the most part, that's okay. You can check a few frames, but then you can send the whole thing out to be rendered the way we did it at the render farm. It worked for us very well, because what we could do is we could finish a shot from the production perspective, including the composite, and then send it out to the render farm, which was in the US. And all the render farm would have to do was render one blend file and give us an image output that was finally composited. And so we didn't have a lot of complexity getting the files back and forth. It's just render the shot, you know, as simple as possible. And what we got back was a single frame, and because the composite was already done, we didn't have to get all the layers back. And that was really important to us, because we were sending stuff over the internet, our bottleneck was the bandwidth. And if we had to send a huge number of layers in an EXR file or multiple files, then that bandwidth would have really hurt us as far as being able to get stuff fast enough. But because we could use, I think we would save everything as a flat EXR frame that had, I think, the half float format. And EXR has some thermal compression. The files weren't too big. And what we would do is, when they were sending the files back, we had a feature where it would save a PNG preview file automatically as well as the EXR. Kind of like your button in GIMP that saves the file and the preview. And so it would send us those both back, and the PNG would arrive much sooner than all the EXRs would. And so we would be able to start looking at it and making judgments even before we got the final thing. And it's still cool for other reasons to have this integration for one-man projects where you don't have a lot of luxury to have a lot of room between different applications, or the fact that Blender understands all the cool extra data in the layers, like things like normals and Z-buffer and et cetera, and so you can do things with the Z-buffer pass, and you can do things with the normals to relight your scene a little bit in the compositing phase. You can do all sorts of neat stuff, now even more than back then. For doing textures, we use the GIMP. And for textures, we only used 8-bit formats, so we didn't really have a problem there with the limitations of the GIMP.
maybe some higher resolution formats would have been nice for bump maps, but it wasn't really that crucial. So we painted, I think, a lot of 5K and 8K resolution textures, especially for the characters who had to look good on HD and full screen. I guess it slows down a little bit, but it's really fine. So that was kind of good. Subversion for version control. I put asset management between quotes because if you are in the commercial world of doing this kind of thing, you buy expensive programs just for managing your production assets. And we used Subversion, which wasn't really designed for that task, but it worked really well. And we used Python heavily because Blender internally uses Python as a scripting language from a long time ago. And it's very easy to use Python, even if you're not a very good programmer. So it wasn't just the TD who was using it. Sometimes the artists would write short Python scripts to do simple tasks, like, for instance, copy left to right setups for the rigs. You know, they did something like that. Bassett, I think, wrote some scripts to automate committing to SVN straight from Blender from Python, so he could just press a button in the menu. I think he stuck it in the help menu in Blender. So he would go to help and click on commit to SVN, and it would make him type the little commit message, and it would commit it for him right in Blender. So that was kind of a time saver. He also wrote Dr. Epilepsy, which is basically he got bored a little bit and he wrote a Python script that changes the color of your background to eye-popping colors as you animate, and so it's strobing at you constantly. And it's my most often used Python script to this day. And of course, for the rendering, actual final rendering with the render form, we experimented with Dr. Q early on. But the render form was using Mac OS X, and it had some problems running Dr. Q, and we didn't have access enough to their computers to be able to fix it. So our team used Python and the Twisted library to write a bunch of render management scripts that would distribute the jobs over different computers and would detect if Blender crashed on one of the nodes, because an early problem that we would have is that we were getting black frames from crashed nodes that never actually finished their render. So it would detect things like that, and it had a little IRC bot interface that would talk to us on IRC and tell, and we could ask it if a render job was finished or not. So it probably wasn't a very secure way of doing things, but we kind of had security through obscurity because, you know, we were working our own little IRC channel and nobody knew about the bots, and so we kind of got with it. Nobody hacked us or anything. So that was kind of nice. And then we also used Inkscape, mainly for 2D work. One of the things that we used Inkscape for, I can show, it was on my desktop, which now I can't find anything on because I have to shrink my resolution for this display. But there's an Elephant Stream SVG. This is one of the in-progress ones. I have the final one too, for instance, for making this nice vector font that we did the title for. And actually, one of the plans was to release this as a font that people could use, but Matt just simply didn't have time to finish making a whole font as well as making the movie, so we just have the SVG image, but it's pretty nice. We also did some of the titles in Inkscape, and so on and so forth. So that was Inkscape. We also depended on a lot of other software that wasn't necessarily something we thought of consciously. We were running GNOME KDE desktops, using Samba for our file sharing. We used Adobe Emacs a few times just to do certain things with video files. We used FFmpeg libraries. After the voice recording, We used Audacity and Sound Converter to sort of listen, cut up, and convert the sound files to WAV that we could import in Blender. And of course, OpenAccelerator is very important. And probably missing other things, but so we kind of depended on the whole kind of stack of software that's open source, that's not necessarily just graphics production software, but there's a lot of things that are very unique, and so that worked out really well. Like I said, the audio work was done separately in closed source programs, and then we, and so that was that. But while we were working in Blender, we could at least open, we could at least import the WAV files of the dialogue so we could animate to them, so that's this is just a little breakdown just to show the team and kind of show what happens in such a small project is that everyone ends up doing a lot of different things, often in the same day. And it's, you know, so Andy over there, who's happily demoing some Blender modeling, the art director, who's also a modeler, an animator, texture artist, writer, and compositor. And Lee had the luxury of being the most dedicated team member because he's a really good animator, and so we relied on him most for animation purely and kind of freed him up from other tasks, and that worked out well, but he also did some modeling. He didn't get out of it. Basse is in Finland, and he's also, he's a great artist, actually a great 2D artist, and did a lot of concept work for the project. He also modeled a lot of things, not the main characters, but a lot of the secondary characters in the sets, did a lot of animation, did some rigging, and he was also called the Duck Master because there are these characters that we call Swiss Army Ducks. They're like little robots that do things in the machine. And Basse designed and modeled and rigged all of them. And so he was Duck Master. And then Matt, that was the only picture I found of him quickly enough, but he was initially brought him on as our main 2D artist because he's a very solid graphic design background, but he also did a lot of other things, especially the compositing and rendering phase. He was really working hard, but he was also working in the animator before that and in the concept phase. Tom was kind of weird because he was both at the very top and the very bottom of the hierarchy. So he was the guy who came and cracked the whip, and he was the production manager, really doing all the scheduling and the deadlines for us that we never made, but it was really good to have them. Really and also getting all the money for the project, et cetera, as producer. But he was also the lead developer, which meant that we got to demand from him all these things and push him to work really hard for us. So he would give us a deadline, and then we would say, but the crappy software doesn't work. Tony Lazzaro was the technical director. His biggest thing was doing the rendering scripts, actually. That was the most important thing he did for the project. But he actually did some procedural animation early on in the first scene for the large telephone wires moving around. Are basically little canned actions and then a lot of scripting to kind of modify them and make them work together. Jan was our composer and sound designer. He's got a one-man studio in Germany called WaveMage, and he's very high-quality professional work. We're really lucky to have him. He's a big open-source fanatic in a way. He loves Blender, he loves the project, but he says that he can't use it for professional audio work. I don't know if that's right or wrong, but that's his opinion. And then there's me. I was director, but I didn't actually get to do much directing. Maybe 10% of my time there was as a director because I was also animating quite heavily, and I was rigging, which was another big time consumer. And I also did a bit of modeling, a bit of this and that, and I did other things. So that was the team, and I want to talk about the future a little bit at the end of this. time, so it's suggestively blank. But I wanted to make a big announcement, actually, about what the next open movie was going to be like and what the Blended Animation plans are for the future. But it's a little bit too early for the big announcement right now, because it's still being planned. But there is going to be another open movie that the Blender Foundation is sponsoring, and there's going to be a big announcement in June. And so that's what I can tell about it right now. One of the effects of this movie was that it really opened a lot of people's eyes to open source software and to Blender. And during the production, what we like to call a very courageous studio in Argentina is actually making the world's first full-length animated feature film made in Argentina and also made entirely with open source software. And they're using Blender for their animation tool, and they benefited a lot from our experience. Both during the project and also afterwards, Andy and myself went to the studio there, and we worked there for a couple of months, sharing knowledge. And they have a technical director who is now a CBS committer for Blender, so that's kind of cool. Not many movie projects can say that they have commit access to their main production tool, but these guys do. And the movie itself isn't an open movie like Elephant's Dream is. It's a more traditionally distributed and marketed movie, but these people are very much into open source and really want to share a lot of the improvements. Like, for instance, they want everything they do, if possible, in CVX, you know. And that's both good for them, because then they don't have to maintain it anymore. And it's also good for everyone else, because they are doing cool things. And also any scripts that they make, et cetera, they are going to release. That would be very beneficial for everybody. And the nice thing about using open source software is that, they're in Argentina, and the budgets cannot be as high as Hollywood movies. And so just the licensing cost alone is enough for them not to be able to do this with my actual students. But there's a bigger benefit, like you mentioned about their TV has commit rights, is that they can create an ecosystem of artists and developers who don't have a barrier between them and sort of the rest of the world, because the open source software doesn't really throw up barriers in your face. It's very inclusive, and so they're not like a satellite of Hollywood or like the sort of lesser child. They can be their own thing and do stuff independently and still be connected to the Blender world and to the game world and everything else that they're using. And that's really cool. And they don't only have their technical director as a Blender creator, they also have other developers who are Spanish-speaking who got interested in the movie project and aren't actually located at the studio, but they're actively developing Blender and doing enhancements at the same time, working with us. So they're connected into a wider world, and obviously the Blender project is helping them a lot. There are more and more studios and freelancers using Blender for production. And that's something that's always been around, sort of behind the scenes, even before the open source days. But I feel like it's gathering more momentum. I mean, I'm one of them, but I worked before, so I don't count. But a lot of other people that are looking at it, actually, even some people who I, as an animator, consider to be some of the world's best animators, are saying things that I don't usually have the courage to say, like, oh, Blender is the future of 3D production, you know, like, this is the guy who's coming from Maya, and like, he barely has touched Blender, and he's already doing great stuff in it, so that really is kind of cool. Because I don't have a lot of things to say about the Blender Foundation's project, I'm going to talk a little bit about my own, but they're much less exciting, smaller scale. So, since Elephant Stream, I've been working as a freelancer with the idea that I could fund myself to make open movies, open shorts movies at least. And I do have some plans. I'm based in the US in Massachusetts, to try to do something on a similar scale to, a similar idea to what the Brenda Foundation is doing in Europe, but maybe on a smaller scale. And my website is Free Factory, and I'm kind of pursuing financing to do some kind of small open studio that can kind of exist and figure out a way to self-support itself and also produce open content. I have a I have a short in development that we can see a little bit of my cracking at it from, because that's as far as I've gone right now. So I'll show a little bit of this. And this is the most public place I've showed it. So as you can see, I'm also using SVN structure and libraries and production. And the crack names is because they're crapping addicts. But I'll show the edit. Let's see if you can see it. Actually, let me. I'll go from after the little dissolve in the beginning. This slows things down a little bit. But I'll just go a little bit afterwards. So this is very rough, early animatic work for this project. And I actually haven't designed the character yet. So I just made more of it. It's going to be a woman, but I don't know what the character design is so far. So I just made this kind of generic low poly woman mesh that I'm just using for the animatic. And she's a linked group. With a proxy for the animations. So I won't show too much of this because it is kind of rough and boring. Some of the cool things about it though is that I'm using some features to make it look a little bit better. So I'm using very low quality renders, but I baked ambient occlusion into all my animatic files. So there's baked lighting in the objects and no lighting in the actual scene. So they render really fast. So I don't do actual OpenGL. I'm actually rendering with no anti-aliasing. And then I'm using the compositor to do, so I can actually preview things like focus pulls and things like that already in the animatic phase. So. Okay, the way I did it then is using the time node and the compositor. And using some blurs and different layers. You can use the depth of field node right now. There's a defocus node in Blender that uses the Z buffer to blur already as an input. And it uses, the camera has a focus point that you can animate in your 3D scene, actually. And the node uses that. And it's pretty cool. I've been using it a lot. It does have some limitations because it's a post-process effect. It's not real depth of field. And it can lead to some ugly artifacts in some cases. So it needs a little bit of working around. But it's really kind of seductive to use at the same time because it's kind of cool. So that's the animatic. I can show an image, which is kind of like the preview image of what I want the project to look like, which I have shown publicly, but I didn't tell people what it was for. This is a great organization that I'm exposing myself to. It's so bad. And I'm talking about pipelines and all that. And then this is what I'm actually doing.
I didn't show up in the list, but
Oh, you did. Okay. So this is actually what the movie is supposed to look like.
Okay.
The stairs keep going down in the beginning. The character, when I did this image, I was thinking of using a male character for the and then I switched my idea to be the female. So that's kind of the visual look I'm going for the movie. It looks gruesome, but it really isn't. It's really just an appearance. This person isn't hurt in any way. So that's that. Another thing I'm doing right now is, and I'm not the only person doing this, there's a lot of open content available for Blender right now, which I think of as kind of in a full-blown way, so called an ecosystem of open production. And maybe it's the beginning of such an ecosystem, because if you have more open movie projects, if you have people sharing knowledge and code and enhancements to existing open source projects, and also sharing assets, which is happening already, then you can kind of have a kind of an ecosystem of people doing production work, and maybe some of it's fully open, maybe some of it's just taking advantage of the open content that's out there, and hopefully giving something back at the same time. But we can get, maybe we can get to a different idea than this kind of property idea of thought, of human thought, that really, to me, doesn't fit with some things that I think are more important than just profit. You know, like building on other people's work, like communicating freely, like not closing off barriers of communication to one group or the other because you've decided that they're consumers of information and you're going to monopolize. Using the Blend files, it's using just the video.
Oh.
Yeah.
In the biological science community, there are a bunch of people that want to use animation programs to do biomechanics, that is, to explore, for example, to assemble a paleontological skeleton, look at the range of motion that the joints imply, and then begin thinking about how much musculature needs to be there, how much energy is consumed, things like that.
That's really helpful.
And primarily people have used Maya to do that, and I've been watching Blender. I don't know Blender really at all myself. I don't know, and I'm not a biomechanics person, but I've been trying to tell people about the possibility of using free software to do this work. And I'm wondering if you have any
suggestions about where people could get started if they were interested in doing that kind of work with Blender. Do you think Blender could be adapted for that? Is it ready to do that now?
Because I'm not familiar with that field, I'm not sure what their requirements are. So I can't say off the top of my head if it's ready now or not. But I can also guess from the Blender perspective that these people could bring something new to the table as well. So maybe something unexpected could happen if they were to get involved. The main places they can go to are the Blender.org website, which has extensive documentation on the wiki. They can also go to Blender Artists, which is primarily a forum site for people using Blenders, and it has a lot of general support forums where people can either search for or ask their own questions and get answers pretty rapidly. There's IRC channels, Freenode, and there's the mailing lists. So there is quite a lot of places that they can go to talk to developers and users of the software. So that's pretty available. Unfortunately, a lot of the assets that are there for the software are scattered right now. There's some on my side. There's some on each person who made their stuff has got their stuff posted on however they did it. And so you can probably search for, if you know what you want, you can probably search for like free rates on Blender Artists and find some things like that. But it really would be nice to have a repository that at least linked to where you could download it so you could just go and get something. And I think biomechanics, but that sounds interesting to me too, because maybe it could lead into more simulation of how things actually move, as opposed to the kind of abstractions that are typically used in Django and other animation software to animate things. So maybe things like, and maybe things like muscles and real kind of driven simulated motion could be possible. Or people from those fields are kind of getting into Django and software. It could lead to new and interesting things.
What about content licensing? Does everything need to be licensed, public domain, to really make it useful in this community, or does it have community knowledge?
A lot of people, that's something that there needs to be a little bit more of kind of a public consensus about. A lot of people just release their files and they don't think about the license. So they just say, here, you guys can use it. Mostly it gets treated like public domain in that case. The first release of the Canopy Man MDI made was a public domain release. My attitude towards it was that for it to be really useful for people, I couldn't really restrict them as to what they would do. Probably now, in the new version of it, I'll probably pick a Creative Commons license and just use the least restrictive one that lets people use it as really as possible. And I think Creative Commons might be nicer for the artists to use because they have a bunch of licenses and they can sort of pick their level of commitment as to how much they're making public. So they don't, it doesn't have to be an either or, like either I'm going to hoard my stuff for myself or I'm going to give it with no restrictions. They can pick kind of where they're comfortable at, and the licensing will make it clear.
We'll have perhaps one question here. We still have a presentation for lunch.
Just on the question of licensing,
have you looked at the Open Font license, which also struggles to allow artists freedom to have their own work with freedom for other people to use it?
I haven't personally actually looked at it, but I do plan on doing some research, or at least maybe asking people more publicly for help. I have been kind of thinking that for the next release of Man Candy, before I actually released it, I would make a post somewhere and ask people what they think would be a good license for him and what their reasons are for it. And that would be kind of a lazy way for me to do some research into what the best license would be.
Thank you. One thing